Hello, and thank you for joining today's information session on NYFA's Rauschenberg Dancer Emergency Grants. Happy to have you here, and we're recording this to make it available on our website. I'm Molly Quinlan-Hayes. I'm the Rauschenberg Grants Coordinator for the New York Foundation for the Arts, and I'm joined today by our Grants Program Associate, Kendra. Kendra, please say hello.
Hi, I'm Kendra. I'm the program associate on the grants team.
And either one of us can answer questions as you move through your application process if you choose to apply. So feel free to reach out to us. Our agenda for today's session is to give you a brief overview of NYFA's programs overall. We hope that if you're not familiar with them, you can access more of our resources. We'll talk about the particular accessibility and privacy considerations in these emergency grant programs. Then I'll actually walk through the entire Dancer Emergency Grants process, including what types of expenses you can request, what the eligibility criteria is to apply, what goes in an actual application, then just some tips and guidance, as well as sharing with you how applications are reviewed and funding decisions are made. If you find and that at the end of the session you have questions that haven't yet been answered, please feel free to put those into the Q&A. You'll see that in your toolbar at the bottom of your screen. And Kendra will be monitoring that, and we'll make sure to cover any questions before we wrap up today. NYFA's programs fall into these four departments. Firstly, awards and grants, which includes this program. And I'll put another quick plug in for the Rauschenberg Medical Emergency Grants. Those are available also over the next 12 months on a bi-monthly basis for recent or upcoming emergency medical, mental health, or dental expenses. And those are open if you are both a choreographer and a dancer. You may be eligible to apply for both. Medical emergency grants are also available to visual artists, film, media, digital, and electronic artists, as well as choreographers. Our fiscal sponsorship program is a means to allow artists who are soliciting donations for projects that they are leading to use our 501c3 status so that you don't need to incorporate as a nonprofit yourself, but we can be a recipient of tax-deductible contributions on your behalf, and then we administer those funds in partnership with you. Our learning department provides a vast array of both in-person and online opportunities for artists and creative workers throughout the arc of your career. So I encourage you to look into all of those professional development opportunities. And finally, our website, NYFA.org, is filled to the brim with resources that we collect that cover all aspects of an artist's creative and business life. Many of them free, and we also have a section on emergency resources. So whether or not you find that the Dancer Emergency Grants are the right match for you and what you need, you might also find resources, financial, social services, housing, legal, in the emergency resources section of NYFA.org. A quick note right up front that I'd like to assure people in terms of the emergency grants is one that we are very committed to supporting artists from every background at all stages of their careers. So these programs are right for artists who are fairly early in their career. You must have at least 5 years of history all the way through, the entirety of your career arc. We strongly encourage LGBTQ plus artists, artists with disabilities, artists of color, and artists living outside of New York to apply. This is a national program, but it's not yet well known in every part of the country. So please know that we are really wanting to receive applications from artists no matter where you live. Also, the nature of this program drives confidentiality. Because we are asking you to share information about what's a distressing time in your life, and which we hope is a temporary one. But we understand that you are having to be forthcoming about some private information. So please know that the only a very small circle of staff members sees and uses your information. Our review panel is also very sensitive to the particulars of this program. They sign a confidentiality agreement, and they are also national. So the likelihood of your crossing paths or having a relationship with one of our panelists, we hope, is minimized as well. And we also want to make sure you know that we have a formal equity and inclusion policy, and you can read our statement about that on our website. So a quick overview of the Dancer Emergency Grants, known to its friends as RDEG. These are one-time grants to professional dancers in need facing dire financial emergencies. We'll define that in a moment. But it's really if you have lost work over the last 6 months or so because of circumstances outside of your control, and that's led you to being in a precarious financial state, that's what this program is really for. You must demonstrate an urgent and critical need for emergency support in your application. And the grants are up to $3,000. These are one-in-a-lifetime grants so that we can serve as many artists as possible. An individual can only receive one of either a dancer or a medical emergency grant in their lifetime. Thanks to our sponsor, the Robert Rauschenberg Foundation, we are able to fund six cycles over the next 12 months. So we will be running a cycle every 2 months from July through June of next year. And in each cycle, we will be awarding about $65,000. So we're able to fund generally between 20 and 25 grants per cycle. You can request less than 3,000 if that's all that you need. Again, I mentioned the privacy considerations, sensitivity around your information. We also do not announce or publish either applicants or recipients of our emergency programs the way we do with our fellowships and such. And this program was launched in 2021, really to respond to the extraordinary loss of opportunities for dancers across the country because of the pandemic. So the need continues, not necessarily COVID-related, but we know that the industry has not picked up yet. But there may be also additional reasons for which you have lost recent work outside of the pandemic, which are eligible, and we'll talk about that. So as I promise, we have some formal definitions. How do we define for the purposes of this program a dire financial emergency? Well, it's that you are lacking or you are in imminent danger of losing rental housing, that includes utilities, medicine or health care, and that includes dental and vision care, food, transportation, and other essential expenses. And it must be because, again, you've lost work over the last 6 months. This is really, we understand this is kind of a stopgap, a temporary assist for you to get through about a three-month period of time. You may have had performances canceled, often without much notice. We have been seeing a lot of dancers whose contracts are being reduced. Not just in pay, but the length of time, the number of weeks that you're contracted for. We've seen that a lot of tours just have not picked up yet after COVID, and there are less of them, so there are less work opportunities. Illness or injury, if you've had an illness or injury over the last 6 months that has meant you're not able to dance and not able to earn as you would normally, that is eligible. And again, you know, we understand that this is born out of the ongoing shutdowns that were due to COVID. So more specifics about the eligible expenses. You can ask for up to $3,000 for the expenses that were on the prior slide for up to a three-month consecutive period. So in cycle 13, which is open as this information session is being held, any 3 months worth of expenses between January of this year and the end of this year are eligible. So it might be that you are in arrears of your rent and utilities for the last 3 months. That's fine. Or you may have just gotten word that your Summer teaching has been canceled, and so you're going to need to pick up costs for July, August, September. Any 3 months within that period, consecutive months, are eligible. And they can be things that you have already paid and you need to reimburse yourself, things that you owe you haven't been able to pay, or that you know are coming up in the next few months and you're not going to be able to cover them. Some more detail on the types of ways that you can use these funds. Rental housing, so deposits or monthly rent. Utilities, and that can include internet, food, mental, as I mentioned, mental health care, dental care, or medical care. That can include wellness visits, insurance premiums, doctor appointments, actually if you need treatment or physical therapy, transportation, other essential expenses, which you can specify. Those don't come up very often, but occasionally there are certain expenses. One that comes to mind are legal fees for visa issues. Out of the $3,000, because we want you to be able to work and to have the opportunity to earn revenue, up to $1,000, if it's applicable to you, of your request can be for expenses related to maintaining your capacity as a dancer. So if you need to pay for class, if you need, point shoes, if you need gear for auditions, or if you have a studio that you're teaching or choreographing in and you need to pay rent and utilities on that studio for up to 3 months, again, up to a third of your grant request can be for those types of expenses. Now, please bear in mind that there are particular ineligible expenses. Those include, but aren't limited to, mortgage payments. So again, rental expenses eligible, mortgage payments are not. We can only cover expenses related to you as the dancer, not to other family members. And although they are important, we are really wanting to assist you with kind of basic life essentials. So we're not able to cover things like student loan payments, credit card debt, taxes in arrears, those kinds of things, nor can we cover the purchase of vehicles or other equipment. And we reserve the right to determine what is considered eligible and reasonable. Should you have questions about expenses that don't fall neatly into one of these categories, please feel free to reach out before you submit your application. We're happy to talk that through with you. All right, moving to eligibility. There are three kind of buckets of eligibility in this program. We found breaking it out these three ways makes it a little bit more understandable, but you do need to meet all three of these in order to be eligible to apply. So I'm gonna walk us through all three of these and know that they all have to converge for you to be eligible for a Rauschenberg Dancer Emergency Grant. The first being individual. So pretty basic here. You have to be 21 years or older on the grant deadline for the cycle in which you're applying. You must reside in the U.S. So that includes the District of Columbia, tribal nations, and U.S. territories and jurisdictions. You do not need to be a citizen. You just need to have current residence in the U.S. This is limited to artists in need, meaning we have an income ceiling to apply. So you need to have an adjusted gross income over your last two tax returns of $75,000 or lower. If you file jointly, that bumps up to $150,000. You cannot be enrolled in a degree-seeking program at the time you apply. And you do need to demonstrate current and ongoing activity as a professional dancer. And we will talk about that next in our artistic eligibility bucket. So you must have been working as a paid live dancer in public-facing settings since at least 2019. You don't need to be a full-time dancer. In fact, if you are performing at least one paid engagement annually, you are eligible for this program. We understand that you might have other ways that you need to earn income, but you do need to be paid. And we do understand, of course, that if you are inactive or only doing online activity in 2020 and 2021, and that there's that gap on your resume, we understand that. And again, obviously, if you've been inactive for some or all of the last 6 months, that's what this program is all about. When we are looking at this artistic history, please know that the program, and this is defined in partnership with our funder, the Robert Rauschenberg Foundation, it's about assisting and getting you back to working in public settings, whether those are free festivals, concert dance, wherever, workshops, residencies, wherever the public has a chance to encounter your work. So if you only are presenting your work online, then that is not eligible in the artistic history. And we also can't consider dance that's taking place in competitive settings, in academic or educational or pre-professional settings, social dance, or in commercial or private settings. So again, has to just be, you know, available to the public, whether it's ticketed or not. And the third bucket is the type of emergency. It again must be a dire financial emergency because of something that's happened in the last 6 months that is endangering your ability to pay for your basic essentials. These need to be direct out-of-pocket expenses for you individually that you are responsible for paying. And again, there needs to be something that happened in the last 6 months out of your control that has left you without the work opportunities that you would normally have. And as with being a resident of the U.S., all of the expenses have to be incurred and paid within the U.S. So those are our three eligibility buckets. Now let's talk about what actually goes into the application. And I will preface this by saying we have streamlined the application. We are trying to keep it as short and sweet as possible because we know that you wouldn't even be considering applying for this program unless you were in a bit of a stressful situation. So we try to keep it as streamlined and easy for you to apply as possible. And we put steps in place so that even if you've never written a grant before, you should not need to be an experienced grant writer to be successful in this program. It's just about giving us some basic information and telling your story. The first thing that you'll find when you go to apply on our website is that, and everything is done online through a platform called Submittable. It is free. If you've not yet used Submittable, you can sign up for a free account. It activates immediately. It just is connected to your email address. But first of all, there is an eligibility form that asks these questions with just a, and you just answer yes or no. Are you 20? Will you be 21 on the deadline? Do you reside in the US? Is your income under the ceiling? Are you in school or not? Have you previously received a grant? And have you actually been actively dancing since 2019? I encourage you to answer these questions truthfully because if you're not eligible for some reason, we don't want you to take the time of completing an application. And then we need to come back and tell you that it's not eligible and we can't consider it. Your time is precious and valuable. And we would rather you know this up front and you know we can help redirect you to some other resources. So you know this is kind of a check for your sake. If all of these things are true and you're able to answer yes, then you'll move into the formal application form. Some basic information, factual information, your contact information, your name, your location, your phone, your email. There is a checklist that just asks you about your economic situation and you just check the things that are true for you. We ask for your annual income averaged over the last 2 years. Please make sure that this, don't ballpark it, don't guesstimate it, because you'll also need to submit your tax returns and the two need to jive. Then you give us a short answer to summarize your typical and recent professional activity. You know, I've been, performing for the last 6 years with XYZ Ballet Company. 2 months ago, they announced that, half the company was not going to be working over the summer, you know, just something really brief. Then you have 200 words to describe your dire financial emergency. And we encourage you to answer these two questions. What's your urgent and critical need for financial support? And what circumstances led to your current financial emergency? This is where you just can get specific and just tell the review panelists what exactly is going on with you. And then there is a short answer for describe one step you'll take towards stability. And this, we understand that 3 months of expenses is not a long-term fix for you. We're trying to help artists, you know, have a break from the financial stress for a few months, be able to pay their bills and step back a little bit and do a little bit more long-term planning and thinking. So that's what this question is about, is providing that opportunity for you to just think about things that you might be able to put in place if you get a breather through this grant. Then you will list the types of expenses for which you're requesting the funds. We ask you to certify that everything in the application form is true. We'll ask you to upload a current bio or resume that shows your artistic history. And then you'll upload your federal tax returns for the last 2 years. Again, we maintain everything is on a secure server. We ask you to redact your social security number. But again, this is so that we have as much information on hand as possible, because once we do award the grants, because these are emergency grants, we move everything as quickly as we can. And if we have everything on file, then we can get, you know, payments started immediately after the decisions are made. In the application form, I mentioned that you fill out your expenses, and I'd like to bring your attention to this. In the application form, you'll find these budget tables for each of the eligible expenses. So one for housing, utilities, food, et cetera. Each one looks like this. It has a header. So, oops, I'm sorry. So the rental housing expenses, and then you fill out information over here in the right-hand column. So for instance, in this example, from an actual application, we ask you to describe the expense, monthly rent payments, fairly straightforward. If there's a one-time expense, maybe you are having to move into a new place to room with somebody or, you know, whatever it is. But if you just need if there's a security deposit of $800, then you want to list that there is a one-time security deposit. Then you're going to list the actual expenses. So if there's a security deposit of $1,000 or $800, you would put that in line 3. Your monthly expense, so this artist's monthly rent payments were $1,160. They're asking for 3 months. And then that total is at the bottom. And there's a big red arrow there because that bottom line must be completed for us to accept it as a formal request. So this artist, their rent is actually more than the $3,000 maximum grant award. That's fine. You can tell us what your actual expenses are, but please be sure for any type of expense that you are requesting that you make sure to fill out line 6. Otherwise, we can't consider it an eligible expense. Okay, another thing that is a requirement that we hate to have things bounce back is to make sure that you have all the right information in your resume. You don't need to create a new resume or bio just for this program. Again, we know your time is precious, but make sure that this information is included. And if you need to annotate it or highlight it, you know, that's fine. But these are the basics that we need to be able to see in your resume. One is a list of your engagements, live dance engagements as a paid performer since at least 2019. If you've been dancing longer than that and that's on your resume, that's fine. In each one, make sure that it is listed the production or event name, what your role or position was. If you are a principal dancer, if you were the prince, whatever your role or position was in the piece, the year that was performed and the location. Please don't just say, I was a member of City Ballet from 2018 to 2022. We need the actual credits. If you perform your own work, please indicate somehow that you were both a choreographer and a dancer. Again, you don't need to craft a special resume for us. If you have other performance work that you have done, maybe you're doing film work or music videos, you know, things like that, that's great. But if make sure that it's obvious to us which the live public-facing performances are. Again, understanding that there may be gaps because of the pandemic shutdown or because of your recent loss of work. We don't look at work samples or URLs. Need is the only criteria in this program. So artistic merit is not. So we look at artistic history and your financial need, and that's it. So don't worry about sending us links or videos or URLs. We don't need work samples. A couple of tips about the filling out the application. Again, it's all online via submittable. If you do require an accommodation, we are also happy to assist you. But just reach out to us to ask for alternative ways of applying. Emergencyfunds@nifa.org is my email address. And our number is 212-366-6900, and I'm at extension 239. Please don't wait until the deadline. If you inquire a week or two at least before the deadline, so we can make sure to turn it around and make sure your application is submitted in a timely manner. Again, we have about $65,000 in each of our six cycles this year to fund. The demand for emergency funding is high, so applying early does not give you an advantage. Nor does it guarantee you funding. So I really recommend that you take the time to go through the application. Again, you needn't be a professional grant writer, but you know, tell your story with enough specificity that the panelists really understand what your situation is. Rushing through does not help. Missing information just means I'll have to come back and ask for it. So take the time that you need to submit a complete and detailed application. And if you have questions or are missing information, please reach out to me before the deadline so we can work on answering those and getting it resolved. Because once your application is submitted, we have to accept it as is. So let's take care of things before you submit. You can also work on a draft in submittable and save it and go back to it as many times as you need before you formally submit it. What happens after your application is submitted? Staff checks it to make sure that it is complete and that you are eligible. So we look at those three buckets: individual eligibility, artistic, and the eligible expenses. Then our eligible applications go to our peer panel. So these are fellow dancers, choreographers, dance educators, dance presenters from around the country who've all signed a confidentiality agreement. And they are just looking at your economic urgency and need. Then the top scoring pool, based on those scores, is put into a lottery. This is something that we instituted very early in our emergency grants program because, to be honest, there are more artists in need than we have funds for. And it just, there is not a humane way to kind of pit one person's emergency situation against another. So the top pool of scores just goes into a random lottery, and we score from the top down until we run out of funds for that cycle. It just seems like giving it over to the universe is the most fair way to make that final decision. We try to announce the to everyone what the status of their funding is or is not within 6 weeks of the cycle deadline. And as I mentioned, because we collect as much as we can up front, there's very little paperwork to be done on the back end so that we can get grant awards paid within 3 to 4 weeks of the cycle's end. We do it even more swiftly whenever we can. Again, we do not announce publicly any information about applicants or grantees in this program. And if you continue to be eligible, but you're not funded, you can roll over or apply in future cycles. So we have had artists that have applied multiple times and have been funded in a later cycle. We've had people who are funded their first time, and we've had people who funded who have applied multiple times and not been funded. You know, it's partly a need basis and partly the lottery basis. So just know that those are the two pieces that go into the final decision. Okay, I'm going to go through some frequently asked questions. And again, these are all also available on our website, but I will talk them through. What's the difference between the Rauschenberg Medical Emergency Grants and the Dancer Emergency Grants? The first is who is eligible. For the medical grants, you must be active for over at least the last 5 years as a choreographer, or a film or media artist or a visual artist. Whereas in the dancer emergency grants, you must be active as a professional dancer over at least the last 5 years. There are a small community of people who are eligible for both, and that's fine. You may apply to both, though you may only be funded once. The other distinction is what expenses are eligible. In our medical emergency grants, it's just out-of-pocket emergency costs for medical, mental health, or dental treatment. In the dancer emergency grants, although medical care is one potential expense, you can also use the funds for housing, utilities, food, transportation, and other essential expenses. Can I apply to both? Again, yes. If you are both a choreographer and dancer and you're active in both since at least 2019, and you have eligible expenses that match the a different program requirements. But again, you can only ever receive one Rauschenberg grant through NIFA in a lifetime so that we can serve as many artists as possible. So if you have received a medical emergency grant in the past, you may not apply for a dancer emergency grant. And again, by applying, are you guaranteed to receive funds? No. We have this pool available. We'll have six of these cycles between July 2024 and June 2025, and there is high demand. We generally, you know, we can't control the number of applications that we get per cycle. We can fund about 20 or 25 grants per cycle. And so depending on how many applications we get, that means that we're funding anywhere between 25 to 40% of the eligible applications that we use. Again, to just talk through the process to determine who receives a grant, there's a staff check to make sure that you are eligible and your application is complete. Those eligible applications move forward to our panel. They look only at economic urgency based on your narrative responses. And then the top scoring pool moves into our lottery. Just to reiterate what we're looking for in the resume to demonstrate your recent and sustained commitment to performance. It must be that you have been paid to do live dance performances over at least the last 5 years, since 2019, in any performance style, ballet, jazz, modern, musical theater, as long as it's a dance-focused role, you know, tap, street, any performance style, circus. But what is not eligible in the dance history, meaning that we can't count it towards that at least one performance a year for 5 years, anything that you're doing in school or in academic settings, anything that is in a competition, any kind of social dance, private-based events, commercials or industrials, or work that's presented online. More frequently asked questions. I'm a choreographer. May I apply? Yes, if you can also demonstrate that you have had an active dance performance history over the last 5 years. I perform in film and television. May I apply? Yes, if you are also working in live performance and you might have had a mix, and if you did something that was available for broad public viewing. So a film that was distributed, a series that was presented in a series format. But again, if it's just a series that is just broadcast online, And it's available on demand, that is not eligible either. Again, if you perform in musical theater, you may apply as long as your credits are, primarily dancer roles. And if you're a teaching artist, you may apply, but again, you need to also be working in live professional public performance over the last 5 years. I think we have hit this one multiple times, but what is not eligible? Competitive dance, in education settings, social dance, and in commercial spaces. The housing expenses that you may request are monthly rent and security deposits. Mortgage payments are not eligible. The utilities expenses you may request are monthly electric, gas, internet, and cell phone, also up to 3 months. And you can request food expenses of monthly groceries and prepared food for up to 3 months. These grants are not eligible for dine-in restaurant expenses. And in terms of transportation expenses, you can request funds for public transportation, vehicle payments and insurance and fuel, ride shares and taxis. And also what's not on this list, but airfare should you need to change locations for work or to get to a stable living environment, you can explain that and request airfare. Medical expenses can be requested for mental health, dental, or medical essentials, including keeping your insurance premiums paid up, treatment and appointments, wellness checks are fine, prescriptions, and personal hygiene. Again, there are other expenses related to working as a dancer that you can request up to $1,000 of your application to maintain your abilities to keep working. So class fees, dance gear, physical therapy, or studio rent and utilities for income generating activities. I'm gonna say this again, just because this is one of the most frequent missing pieces that we receive in applications. In your resume, please be sure that it is very clear what your engagements are, at least over the last 5 years, including the production or event name, your particular role or position in that piece, or that evening, or that production, the year in which it was performed, and the location. If you do not list this information, it will be bounced back and you will have to do it anyway. And if you are both the dancer and choreographer, you can note that. You can just asterisk it or highlight it and add a little note that that's what that means. Again, just please don't fall into the trap of the most common errors that we see, which are that the resume doesn't list your very specific credits in terms of your role and the year and location, and the budget tables are not totaled. If you do not fill out line 6 in the budget tables, we can't consider that expense as a request. Do I need to demonstrate the loss of work or engagements or income to apply? That's the yes. That's the particular point of this program. So we ask you to just describe your typical historical work as a dancer, and then what has changed over the last 6 months and why. And then you have the chance to describe for the panel your urgent and critical need for emergency funding. You may not request expenses for other members of your family or domestic partners. And again, it is not to your benefit to apply early. The applications all go to the panel at the same time. So please don't wait till the very last moment, but take your time to prepare a strong and complete application and put your best application forward. We will have 6 applications over the next 12 months. So the timelines for the next 3 have been published. Cycle 13, which is currently open and closes July 30th of 2024. Applicants will be notified in September if they are funded or not. Cycle 14 opens the same day that Cycle 13 closes. That's not a typo. And the application deadline is August 27th. These are all Tuesdays with a notification by October 4th. And cycle 15 opens September 10th with a deadline of October 8th and notification right before Thanksgiving. Please note that all applications open and close on a Tuesday, and the submittable application automatically closes at 5 p.m. Eastern. And that's just the way the system works. So please don't wait until the last minute. If there is a technical failure on your end or some other thing that prevents you from meeting the deadline, we can't accept the application. So, you know, if at all possible to send it in a day or two early, that's great and makes everybody comfortable. And you will get an automated message from Submittable that it's been received. So you might want to hang on to that that message until you know, the process is complete. If you do not receive a confirmation message, please reach out to us ASAP so we can figure out if there's a gum up in the system. Great. I will ask Kendra if there are any questions in the Q&A.
There are no questions at the moment.
Okay. Thank you. We are happy to respond to questions that you may have. And all of this information is available on our website at NIFA.org/RDEG for Rauschenberg Dancer Emergency Grants. And also, if you're interested in exploring the medical emergency grants, you can find all of that information at NIFA.org/RM, as in medical EG. Thank you for the work that you do. Please spread the word to your colleagues. We appreciate your taking the time. Take care.